The year was 1934. It was the end of the Great Depression. A brand new Dodge cost around $600. Gas was just 18 cents a gallon. And an ice cream cone ran you a nickel. It was the big band era. Benny Goodman, Glenn Miller, and Count Basie. It was a time of comic book heroes. Flash Gordon, Buck Rogers, and Dick Tracy. Jerry Siegel and Joe Shuster were two 19-year-old kids from Cleveland, Ohio, a Midwestern industrial city. Siegel aspired to be a hotshot reporter, but nobody really wanted to give him a chance. Now, almost a half century later, he recalls the night he came up with what he thought was quite a novel idea.
In 1934, one night, as I lay there, ideas kept coming to me. I thought of different things which had happened to me in real life, how frustrated I was and how spectacularly unsuccessful I was with the ladies and all that. And I had wanted to be a reporter. All these elements came together in Superman from Another Planet, who worked as a mild-mannered reporter, Clark Kent, for a newspaper, and was scorned by Lois Lane, the girl reporter. Well, more and more ideas kept coming to me, and I dashed right over at Joe's house. He lived about 12 blocks away.
Joe, of course, is Joe Shuster, at that time a budding young artist, and the other half of the team that created the modern-day monument to the forces of good in this world.
Well, I was inspired just as much as Jerry. I was so enthusiastic about it, I sat down on my drawing board. We didn't stop for breakfast. We worked all morning, all afternoon, started conceiving the whole thing. That one afternoon, we had the entire concept.
Out of this concept was born the legend that was to become the greatest comic book superhero of all time. Hero of millions, fighter of evil, the one, the only, the original super-powered superhero who has captured our hearts and our imaginations for nearly 50 years.
The Adventures of Superman.
Faster than a speeding bullet. More powerful than a locomotive. Able to leap tall buildings in a single bound.
Superman.
The History of Superman, a very special. Tracing the legend of the Man of Steel from his comic book beginnings through his development in the media of radio and television, right up to his current multi-million dollar celluloid status. The History of Superman, starring the same incredible cast that breathed life into what were once just two-dimensional characters, turning them into flesh and blood for moviegoers around the world to cheer. Actors like Christopher Reeve as the Man of Steel himself.
People are looking at their dreams when they look at Superman.
Margot Kidder as the unstoppable Lois Lane.
Lois has two completely different sides.
Criminal mastermind Lex Luthor, played by Gene Hackman.
As an actor, that kind of thing is always great fun.
Lex Luthor's lovely but dizzy girlfriend, played by Valerie Perrine.
It was great fun.
The unbelievably wicked General Zod, made all too real by actor Terrence Stamp.
Those wicked kids are going to love me.
And many more. The year was 1939. Germany invaded Poland on September 1st. World War II had begun. In Europe, the attention focused on Churchill and Hitler, while in America, the limelight was on Mickey Rooney, the number one box office star of the year. December 15th saw the long-awaited release of the epic Gone with the Wind. A real-life legend had his first starring role in a movie, John Wayne in Stagecoach. But on June 12th, several years after the inception of the character, Superman appeared in print for the first time. A legend had begun. The manner in which the comic strip took off seemed like a wayward dream to creators Jerry Siegel and Joe Shuster. Even the names of their prime characters were based on their own personal big screen heroes.
Clark came from Clark Gable, and Kent came from Kent Taylor. Both were popular stars at that time. Lois Lane, the Lane sisters were very popular in movies at that time, and I liked the name Lola Lane, and I made a play on that, Lois Lane, and it was...
Superman. Siegel and Shuster had no idea that their concept would grab hold of a nation and never let go. America was ripe for a superhero who could ride us out of the Great Depression in grand style and provide a full share of romance, adventure, and excitement as well. And Superman, as created by the two kids from Cleveland back in the 1930s, definitely filled the bill. So how did Superman become a leading man in the 30s? Definitely filled the bill. So how did Superman become a leading man in the world of comic book fans?
The Superman story was used...
Saul Harrison, recently retired, longtime president of DC Comics. Superman's home on the printed page.
At first, it went slowly, getting Siegel and Shuster to write and draw more chapters to the original story that was created. And then it just grew like Topsy. More and more work had to be done. The character got calls for putting him on the radio. It became big after the first few months.
I remember the first copy of Superman coming out, and I just loved it. 1938, when I was 7 years old.
From Major Nelson in I Dream of Jeannie to the outwitted Army Commander in Superman the Movie to the wicked J.R. in the hit TV series Dallas, Larry Hagman recalls his first real-life encounter with Superman.
So I remember when it came out, and it was just marvelous, this omnipotent being, you know, that could do all the things for good, and all the evil people were vanquished. And yeah, I suppose it was a symbol of my life. That was when America was the good guy, you know, we weren't in any bad wars. When all Americans wore white hats and rode on white horses and carried white guns, and, you know. Now it's not quite the same. A bit tarnished, isn't it?
The year 1940 saw Superman leap out of the pages of the comics and onto the airwaves. That's when, recalls Sal Harrison, DC Comics got into the radio business, courtesy of their first genuine superstar, Superman.
Originally, in the radio series, DC actually hired their own production people. A team of well-known people in the field were put together. And the line of the character, you still listen to those tapes today, are as good today as they ever were then.
The radio series attempted to flesh out the characters in Superman with just the right voices. So, three times a week, Bud Collier played the Man of Steel on the radio. Although if he seems slightly more intimidating than the Superman you're used to, just keep reminding yourself this is vintage material.
Jack, look, what's that up ahead in the middle of the road?
I don't know. It's a man, isn't it?
I think so, but what's he doing on the road? Jack, look out!
Good thing he got out of the way. We'd have smeared him all over the road.
I thought sure you were going to hit him. Did you see what he was wearing?
Yeah, it looked like a red cape.
That's what I thought.
Hey, what's happening?
We're slowing down.
No, it can't be.
We're stopping.
But it's crazy. The motor's racing.
It won't be for long. Pardon me while I reach in and turn the ignition key.
What?
Here we are.
Hey, what's the big idea? Who are you?
Get out of the car, both of you.
No, wait a minute.
I'm not in the habit of waiting. Get out. Come on, make it fast. All right, I'll help you out.
Just go. You're breaking my arm.
That's only a sample. Come on, Miss Roebling.
I'm coming.
That's better.
Jack, it's the fellow with a cape. The one who was on the road.
No, we're seeing things. It can't be.
You're not seeing things. Not quite certain what your game is, but I can imagine it isn't on the level.
Jack, here's the gun.
Put your hands up or I'll shoot.
You think that little pearl-handled toy frightens me?
Get your hands up or I'll let you have it. Stand back, I said.
Too bad you couldn't see those bullets bounce off my chest. It's a pretty sight.
Jack! Jack! He's still standing.
Well, six shots. That means the gun's empty.
From the golden age of radio to the very first appearance of Superman on the silver screen in 1948 was quite a spectacular step, even for the Man of Steel. Kirk Allen says he also remembers it being an embarrassing step.
I was the first human being to have nerve enough to put on the tights and go out there and make a fool of himself. That's how I felt when I first did it.
Kirk Allen was our very first real live cape and tight Superman. And he says from Superman on the airwaves to Superman in three dimensions meant a lot of alterations.
When I did Superman, I heard the radio show years before, for many years. And hearing the radio show, they had cliches and they had standard lines like up, up and away, and this looks like a job for Superman and all that. Well, you do that because you can't see what he's doing. You see, you have to imagine what he's doing. And he's got to tell you that he's going to change into a Superman clothes and go off and fight whatever the evil he has to fight. and he has to tell you all these things. Now, when you're watching the fellow on the screen, it's a little ridiculous to say up, up, and away, or this looks like a job for Superman, because you do it all with your looks. People know by looking at your face what you're going to do.
One thing people didn't know Superman would do, however, would be to appear in their very own living room. Courtesy of a magic glowing box known as television. Coming up, Superman leaps from the small screen to the big screen in a single bound. The year was 1953. Richard Milhouse Nixon was vice president of the U.S. The Korean War became just another battle-filled memory. The big names of the day were Dwight Eisenhower, Joseph McCarthy, General Douglas MacArthur, Dr. Martin Luther King, James Dean, Marilyn Monroe, Willie Mays, and Davy Crockett. It was the birth of rock and roll. And a musical legend was in the making. Elvis Presley. At the same time, a daring little show that combined the elements of fantasy, fun, and familiarity began a 28-year unbeaten run.
The Adventures of Superman.
A new television legend.
My agent and the man that was casting it said, look, said, nobody will ever see this show. It's a summer's work, and why don't you just take the money and run? And so I did it. I took the money and I ran. I did go to New York. And it came on the air in 1953. We shot it in 51. At that time, there was no film television. And we did these 39 shows, I guess it was. And they went on the air in 53. And, of course, then there you were. A national monument.
If Jack Larson's voice sounded familiar, it's probably because he is better known as Clark Kent's overeager co-worker on the Daily Planet. How could anyone ever forget that good-natured cub reporter Jimmy Olsen, with his short hair and his readiness for whatever trouble Lois Lane was about to get him mixed up in? Jimmy, whose most famous line was without a doubt,
"Golly, Superman, I never thought you'd get here,"
was just one member of the Superman TV family, which DC Comics established back in the early 50s. Former D.C. President Saul Harrison remembers.
We started to do the first stories for TV. We did 105 chapters. We created the production company again. And luckily, I think, got a George Reeves to work in the series, who really became the figure of Superman in the three dimensions.
Oh, the thing I always associate with Superman is, of course, George. He was a completely different kind of person than he was as Superman, and he had a long cigarette holder. And I always, and off camera, George would always be standing there at his cape with his long cigarette holder and the cigarette, which used to make me laugh. I think it was one of the reasons that Jimmy smiled so much, because I just see George there. He'd be doing the reverse lines to me with his long cigarette holder. and as he stood there, and sometimes he'd pick up his cape in front of him, and he was a camp, and I think of it in terms of George, of course.
George Reeves made Superman so real, so convincing, that America had no trouble believing in the Man of Steel and all the astounding feats he pulled off in the television series. Jack Larson, who got his first-hand view of Reeves as Superman while in character as sidekick Jimmy Olsen, remembers.
He played it seriously. Sure, there's wrinkles in the uniform, and George steadily got into tighter corsets, I think. And it wasn't easy. It was a hard part. I had to do a lot of stunts, and did a lot of stunts, and I loved doing my own stunts. Crazy kids that I was, they couldn't get me to do them. Were I acting today, I wouldn't do them. But George was really athletic. He could go out those windows on a diving board. If they were smart enough to cut quickly, they cut where his feet and legs buckled up, and he went under. Sure, he made a convincing Superman.
While George Reeves had no problem at all convincing his television audiences back in the 50s that he was indeed the real Superman, some critics, even today, can't figure out Reeves and Superman's appeal. Noelle Neal, who played Lois Lane on the TV show, says it's really no mystery to her.
As somebody in Chicago wrote a very critical review when the show went back on one of the channels and saved their ratings, He said, I can never understand why people watch this show. He said, you have a managing editor, an owner of the newspaper, Perry White, who has three totally incompetent people working for him. And no press room, no people in the hallways because we couldn't afford extras. He said, I never could figure how the Daily Planet got off the ground or got published. Now, it's really quite true. We were really just always flying off somewhere and getting into some, you know, miserable situations and never showing up. And poor Perry, where is everybody? But maybe that's what made people relate to us, I guess. The bumblers and all of us. Somehow we lucked through in the half an hour.
But Superman and his family of friends, admirers, and adversaries were destined for greater glory than a half-hour series of low-budget black-and-white television. 21 years after TV watchers first adjusted their horizontal hole to see George Reeves in cape and tights with a big red S on his chest, a new incarnation of the superest superhero of all was in the making. The year was 1974. Richard Nixon resigned as President of the United States. The Vietnam War officially ended. The Beatles had come and gone. Man had already left his footprints on the moon. Producers Alexander and Ilya Salkind were fresh off their successful film The Three Musketeers, searching high and low for a suitable follow-up project. As they sat in a Paris cafe, Ilya Salkind recalled how Superman swooped down on them, as if from the Eiffel Tower.
I was having dinner with my father in Paris at the Café de la Paix, and we were desperately looking for a good idea after The Musketeers. It was a pretty big success. So I said, why don't we do Superman? I got very excited. But I also said, you see, the point of Superman is if we do Superman now, it's really something that everybody will look up to because everybody is in need for a hero and is in need for a bigger-than-life character representing good. I mean, that's corny, but that's what it is.
From corny to classic was one big step for Superman, but a giant leap for Salkind. And so the search for the star of this incredible epic began. The Superman hunt was on, and right from the start, it took on all the major proportions of the nationwide talent search years before to fill the role of Scarlett O'Hara in Gone with the Wind. Vivian Leigh eventually won the coveted role of Scarlett. However, for the part of the Man of Steel, no one seemed to have the edge. Robert Redford declined. Even a Beverly Hills dentist was auditioned. But in 1976, the question on everybody's lips was, Christopher who?
My first reaction when they said they would put you up for Superman, I couldn't believe it. I thought they had the wrong number completely. And I thought no more about it until the phone rang again in January and they said they want you in London tomorrow to screen test. And I said, oh, no, come on, you're kidding. I can't go to London. We're telling these people enough already. This is ridiculous. There's so many people all over the place. Go to the Y, pick up somebody with some muscle. I mean, let's, you know, really, all these people, they're gonna kick me. If I get Superman, all the heavy people are going to come and beat me up. He said, well, listen, we want you in London tomorrow. I said, I can't. I'm in a play. And my understudy wasn't ready. So anyway, we finally worked everything around, and I thought there's absolutely nothing to lose. Except I was still apprehensive because I didn't know how they're going to do it. How are they going to make this thing happen? And I'll tell you, when the transition point was for me was when I went over to DC Comics and I met Saul Harrison, who was the sort of publisher, and I was really surprised by his intelligence and his perception of the character. He gave me the script and I took it home and I read it once and then I set it down and I read it through again cover to cover. 500 pages, you know, of script. There were some scenes which missed by a mile, some scenes which were funny in the wrong way. There was a scene, for example, in which Superman's flying around Metropolis and he's looking for Lex Luthor, you know, who's completely bald. And he sees this bald man in the street come swooping down on top of them, and it's Telly Savalas who turns around and says, who loves you, baby, and gives him a lollipop. Now, from my way of thinking, that's funny in the wrong way. You know, that's not, that's camp humor instead of legitimate humor. So there were scenes like that which sort of had to go, you know. But in the midst of all that,
was a really terrific story about a man who comes from someplace else, doesn't know who he is, and finds out about it and becomes a leader. And it wasn't corny and mock heroic, and the scenes for Clark Kent were really endearing and funny. And I said, this is getting good. This is really getting terrific. And by the second time I'd read that script, I really wanted to do it.
In just a moment, there's more to Superman than Clark Kent minus the glasses. The year was 1977. Jimmy Carter, a peanut farmer from Georgia, became America's president. Disco became the sound of the times as Saturday Night Fever, John Travolta, and the Bee Gees were rocketed into the limelight. Two legends died, Groucho Marx and Elvis Presley. Meanwhile, an unknown 22-year-old actor with limited screen experience and surrounded by an all-star cast faced the tremendous task of creating a legend, the legend of the Man of Steel. With his beanpole build and inadequate muscle structure, Christopher Reeves saw himself as a strange choice initially for Superman, the original super hunk.
Except for sort of a strong jaw and some clean features, I really had nothing else going for me. Physically, I immediately needed to deal with the fact that Superman is shaped like a triangle. He's got extremely broad shoulders, a very narrow waist. He's really, I don't know, whoever studied anatomy when they did it, they gave any actor an impossible problem just because they drew really pretty much a perfect man, you know? Perfectly muscled and not grotesque. He doesn't look like a heavyweight weightlifter. He doesn't look beefy and sort of, you know what I mean? He doesn't look like he came out of pumping iron. He really is a very classical looking man, like a Greek sculpture. And that's the problem, you know, because I look like a string bean, not a sculpture.
Reeve was determined to play the part without the aid of phony muscles. So he hired a bodybuilder, headed for the gym, and weightlifted his way to a more natural approach to the part. As Christopher Reeve went from string bean to classic Greek sculpture, Clark Kent must also go from mild-mannered reporter to man of steel. And that brings up the age-old problem of, how could anyone possibly not recognize that Clark Kent is Superman?
I felt that in playing Superman, I tried to be somebody who projects openness, calm. He stands at his full height. His eyes are very clear, and he completely looks out at people with calm and understanding. And he's extremely open. All the gestures are very fluid. When he flies gracefully. I mean, even to the extent of having the toes pointed, you know, from modern dance. That he flies either like a human jet or like an extremely graceful bird. You know, he can do anything from hover and make very beautiful movements to absolutely dynamic, you know, straight out old-fashioned stuff. Clark Kent is like you go to the blackboard and you erase all of that. And I would do with just something with backbone control, which comes from something called the Alexander technique. I would shrink about 3 inches. Clark Kent's about 3 inches shorter than Superman. The shoulders become concave. The gestures become apologetic. The man is afraid to express himself physically. The clothes don't fit him, and he's insecure. He has a stutter. He has a Midwestern twang to his voice. He has asthma. He's got allergies. His glasses fog up all the time. I hope I've put these things in without offending, you know, purists, but I do feel that there was not enough difference in the performance of the people who played it before. And we've been very, very concerned to give people something recognizable while at the same time taking them into new territory.
The new territory that Superman got into under the expert guidance of Christopher Reeve was welcomed by Superman fans of the 70s. Besides making the distinction between cautious Clark Kent and heroic Superman even greater, Reeve had another concern, the issue of updating.
I was also concerned to get away from an old-fashioned corny style, which worked for the 50s and worked for that style of movie. If Superman had a line something like, "Yes, Lois, and there's one last piece of unfinished business," I would change that to, "Listen, there's something I've got to do, I'll be right back," which is what a person would say, you know? And I see no reason why he can't be a person. He can fly, walk through walls, stop bullets, repair an earthquake, fix the Golden Gate Bridge. If you see the character actually do these things, then I think in the portrayal of the part you have to go underneath that. So I tried to play the whole thing with understatement, you know, way back, way off that stuff, and make him somebody who's real and accessible, and also put the possibility of failure into every situation. The limiting factor of the television series, I thought, was that you never doubted the fact that he was going to show up. He would always get there on time. He would always take two bars and bend them apart. But why? Why should he? If he doesn't have it covered in every situation, if he doesn't always know the answer, then his achievements are that much more impressive.
Other impressive factors about the movie versions of Superman are super composer John Williams' Superman 1 score and British composer Ken Thorne's inspired arrangements of Williams' material for the Superman 2 soundtrack. Just as most of us find music a welcome release these days, that's exactly what Superman provides as well.
And in these tough, anxious, uncertain times, what people do is they try to find a strong leader.
Dr. Linda Nelson, professor of sociology at the University of California, Los Angeles, explains.
We are looking for a messiah, in a way. They look for a strong, large-sized man. Superman, of course, is that type. Someone who is, in a sense, a kindly moral macho sort of person. An invincible leader who has a really get-tough attitude. Very get-tough. And when a population is faced with anxious, uncertain, tough times, and they're seeking this sort of leader, they'll often seek this leader in images of the past. Superman, for instance, has always been the same. There's something ageless about Superman. He reemerges and he looks pretty much like the comic book character that emerged in the late 30s.
Whatever the reason moviegoers around the world flocked to see the original Superman epic starring Christopher Reeve, somebody must have smelled success early on. It was decided back in the beginning to shoot two movies, Superman 1 and 2, simultaneously. This unique approach to filmmaking kept Reeve on the set for 18 months as the principal character in both films. Marlon Brando's role as Superman's father, Jor-El, required a far lesser period of time, only 12 days. However, it was sufficient time for Brando to give Reeve some sound advice.
He said, "Don't do your own stunts." I said, "I'm sort of in trouble here because I'm in the middle of flying rehearsals and I was planning to do it all myself." He said, "Listen, I was that way too. You know, when I finished Streetcar and it just come out west and, you know, thought I was hot stuff. I thought I'd do everything, you know, that was cool." And it came to a point in Viva Zapata where I was supposed to ride a bucking bronco. So I said to the people, I said, "Bring in the horse. What the hell?" He gets on the horse and in 2 seconds is wiped out and lands on his head on the ground. And he says, "Right, bring me the other horse." The other horse was a sawhorse between two planks on the back of a truck. And he sat there and did that. And so much for stunts, you know. But, you know, he said, "Listen, it's only a movie, you know. And, if, you know, you fall on your head, say goodbye. It's not worth it." But I was too enthusiastic. I couldn't take that piece of advice.
I'm stronger than a locomotive. Yeah. That old saying is true. But I can't understand sometimes, baby, why I'm so weak for you. Yes, I can leap tall buildings in a single bound. When it comes to getting over you, baby, can't get off the ground. But they call me the Superman lover, yeah. They call me the Superman lover, yeah. But something wrong with me to see.
If Reeves sounds almost as virtuous as Superman when he talks about his career, there's another member of the Superman cast who seems somewhat similar to the character in question. Canadian-born actress Margot Kidder sees a lot of herself in her impulsive on-screen identity, reporter Lois Lane.
She's a lot like me. She's very ambitious, very manic, very messy, very driven, and yet at the same time very, very vulnerable, which was not in the comics. She was not really vulnerable in the way that I play. She's sort of klutzy vulnerable and that sort of goofy, funny vulnerable.
Just as Kidder describes herself using mental pictures of Lois Lane, she describes the terrific relationship she enjoyed with co-star Christopher Reeve in terms of one big happy family. Well, most of the time.
Chris and I are very close. It was like having a brother after that long a time. But as in any family, you get to bickering, you know. And we were shooting a part of the sequence where we fly around, and we were in the position of being 40 feet above the ground, strapped together with safety harnesses and unable to get away from each other. And they'd taken this tower out that had got us up there, and filming the sequence, I mean, there was no escape. You were up there for 2 hours. And we started to fight. And the crew was below, 40 feet away, sort of dumbfounded, not knowing quite what to do. And then they go, action! And we would look at each other totally fondly in love and fly along and do our... They cut and we went right back in it. And finally, the ludicrousness of it hit us and we started to laugh. There was no way anyone could stride off. We were stuck there.
Look. Up in the sky, come on, just look. And you see me flying by.
One actor in the Superman ensemble of players who would have more than his share of trouble taking his outfit off, Gene Hackman, who plays Lex Luthor with the aid of an elaborate skull cap.
The ball cap took about 2.5 hours to put on. You put a ball cap on and your head perspires. So they have to leave the back of it open and to let the sweat pour out. And I had long hair that I had to keep to match other scenes that we'd already done. So it was a mess. But really, it was a tough time for me. I'm very grouchy at that point, too.
Lex Luthor is the warped scientific genius who's been tormenting Superman since the comic book days. But happily, he always seems to lose out to the Man of Steel. Academy Award winner Gene Hackman had a lot of fun bringing the fiendishly clever criminal to the screen.
I approached it as a kind of maybe a high-class used car salesman. That he was the kind of a guy who would do anything to make a sale. More than likely, this is the way he started it. And used cars are real estate on a very low level. And became so kind of infatuated with himself and his own intelligence that he put together this monstrous scheme to take over the world.
Hackman had a field day with Lex Luthor, especially in Superman 2, because that's where humor overtook evil.
Hello there. Lex Luthor. Lex Luthor. Possibly you've heard the name, the greatest criminal mind on Earth.
I told you this is a puny planet.
Wait just a moment. Wait. You get to know me better, will you, please? Wait! Look, I can give you anything you want. I can give you the brass ring, the unlimited freedom to maim, kill, destroy.
We have all of this without you. You cannot bargain with what you don't have.
Magnificent one, what I am bargaining with is what you do not have. Superman.
Revenge. We will kill the son of our
jailer.
Revenge.
Revenge! We're cooking, huh?
He flies, then?
Constantly.
He has powers as we do?
Certainly, but, magnificent one. He is just one. Or you are three. Or four, if you count him twice.
We will bring him to his knees.
Wait! First you must find him. And Lex Baby is the only one who knows where he is.
Valerie Chloe Perrine plays Lex Luthor's dizzy girlfriend in both Superman movies.
She's outrageous. Lex has a bald head, so he wears different wigs all the time. And every time he wears a different wig, she wears a different wig. She has red hair and blonde hair, and she wears Cartier jewelry and skin-tight pants and push-up bras. Just really sort of stupid, dumb sidekick.
As Eve Teschmacher, she helps Luthor make an almost bumble jailbreak in the latest adventure. The actress couldn't help but see Gene Hackman's comic side as he played bad guy Lex Luthor. Perrine says that's basically because Hackman's just not the criminal type.
Well, see, when I saw him acting as Lex Luthor, I saw Gene underneath it all. And he's kind of a lovable evil man because Gene is so lovable. There's a scene where Lex, he's got the bald head, like he's in jail, and he doesn't have his wig. And when we were filming it, it was the birthday of the makeup man. One morning, he just put the thing on, and went and got a candle, and attached it to the top of his head and lit it, and went in singing happy birthday to the makeup man. When every time you see Lex Luthor in the bald head, that's all I can think about, is Gene Hackman with the candle on his head.
Hackman does have the ability, apparently, to crack up cast members right and left. Even the stoic Superman succumbed to one of his great comic lines.
And I remember one time in particular when most of the foreign press was assembled on the stage watching the shooting. The French and Italians and Germans and Japanese had flown in. They were watching. They'd the first time they'd ever been allowed on the set. And we were doing the bit in which it called for me to rip open a lead trunk. I was off preparing for the scene in which I have to deliver some line to him, like I'm going to take this box and melt it down and mold your prison bars out of it, or you know, something like that, and rip open the lid of this trunk and deal with the fact that, of course, inside is kryptonite. So we got to the scene, and I'm preparing and getting all worked up and everything, and I think he could see a level of tension working up in me. And on film, on the take, I came over to the box, said my line to him, I'll mold this box into your prison bars, went to open the lid, and it was nailed shut. And he just stepped over very casually to me, and looking straight at me, said, "Sissy."
Coming up, once you've seen him fly, what on earth can he do for an encore? The year is 1981. The price of gas has risen faster than a speeding bullet. Professional athletes are now more powerful than locomotives. Violent crime and inflation have become the number one issues in a single bound. Man has conquered space. 52 American hostages are released from 444 days of captivity in Iran. The music war is on.
On the road again.
It's country versus new wave.
The Whippy-Turn!
Former actor Ronald Reagan is sworn in as 40th President of the United States. And another actor, Christopher Reeve, has become a household word as Superman 1 ends up the most popular film of 1979. A motion picture about a legend has become a legend. And now the question is, can Superman 1 be topped? Will the adventure be continued? Director Richard Lester, who's handled everything from the Beatles' Hard Day's Night to the daring exploits of the Three Musketeers, takes on Superman 2.
The first premise was that in Superman 1, the audience came and saw a man fly. In Superman 2, they have already seen that, and they're saying, okay, of course he can fly, now show us something else.
Of course, something else isn't always that easy to come by. But thanks to the terrible trio of Kryptonian villains pitted against Superman, and the intimate love story that finally emerges, Superman 2 is every bit as exciting and amazing as the first chapter, and a lot more besides. This time around the galaxy, the Man of Steel faces not just one archrival, but a trio of the most deadly supervillains in the world. A fearsome threesome who were once banished from their home planet Krypton to the empty existence of the Bantam Zone. However, the three Kryptonian bad guys are sprung from their jail cell in the Cosmic Void by a bizarre coincidence triggered by Superman himself. And here's what the Man of Steel unwittingly unleashes on our unsuspecting planet. The sinister, sensuous Ursa, a vision in black leather, played by British actress Sarah Douglas.
I told you this was a puny planet.
The doltish brute Non, brought to life by 6'8" ex-heavyweight boxer Jack O'Halloran, as a roaring, snarling Hulk.
He doesn't speak. He is half animal and half human, but he has a very compassionate side of him. He's like a child in his thinking capacity, and he has the strength of, you know, like craziness, you know?
And the vision of evil incarnate in Superman 2, the unrelenting, unredeemable General Zod. The most vicious, violent nemesis in Superman's entire career. Played with great cunning and cruelty by the classically trained actor Terrence Stamp.
This guy should make Hitler look like Mickey Mouse. This guy is really bad. There's nothing redeeming about him at all. So don't think that he's going to be glamorous or romantic. He will be, you know, as ugly as we can make him and as horrific as we can make him. He's an absolutely negative fire element, you know. I mean, he's really dangerous.
When the three black-hearted and black-clad interplanetary criminals land on Earth, they are at first mistaken for tourists from Los Angeles. However, it's mere moments before this illusion is shattered, as they demonstrate their powers are equal to those of Superman.
For me to go up against Terry Stamp, it's like Joe Frazier going against Ken Norton. You know, it's two heavyweights who are equal, so that it neutralizes the strength of all the material objects around. So if a bus is thrown at me by another villain, then that's got the weight of a real bus. It's just we step into a new kind of convention there that the audience has to believe. You know, so if I get a punch in the face from Ursa, man, it hurts. It hurts like crazy. But I never hit a woman. And one of the reasons I do get injured very badly in this fight is because she's about to hit me with a flagpole. I turn around ready to punch whoever it is in the face, and I see that it's a woman, so I delay. And meanwhile, that gives Non a chance to kick me in the head. You know, Superman's a decent guy 24 hours a day.
When General Zod and his co-criminals finally do get a crack at Superman, director Richard Lester says that's where the real challenge is.
Obviously, any sequence where you throw buses at people and destroy part of Metropolis is not easy. And there was one major sequence, which is what we call the wind sequence, where the three villains blow the inhabitants away. But it was not as difficult as some sequences, which to the audience will seem very simple, like one man in the sky kicking another man in the sky. The actual technique of having both of them flying at the same time and making contact one to the other with the techniques that we use to make people fly, because despite what some think, Christopher Reeve is not a natural flyer.
Fly to high.
More human side of Superman 2. The developing romance between Lois Lane and the Man of Steel has some quite intimate scenes, like when Superman wants to do something really special for Lois. Christopher Reeve admits there was an ulterior motive behind this sequence.
It's the middle of winter, and we really needed to get out of London for the winter and stuff. So we decided that what we really needed was a scene where Superman would go someplace really beautiful and get a flower for Lois. We needed something romantic. This was my idea. We've got the joke about him coming in with a bag of groceries saying, "I'm home," which is a good send-up. But he needs to have some flower that you've never seen in your life, you know. Or he should go to Italy for a bottle of wine, you know. Be right back. So we just thought he needed to go someplace great. Where should we go? Well, how about St. Lucia? You know, it's only 8,000 miles away or something like that. So we talked the producers into an 8-day vacation in St. Lucia for two shots, one parrot, and one waterfall, and that's it. And we all went, 50 people went to St. Lucia to get this shot and came back. It was tremendous. And that shot is so romantic, the idea that this guy would go to the tropics for a flower and come back in 2 seconds. I mean, it's necessary, but at the same time, I remember that we were cooking up a vacation, too.
Kent and Lois Lane also get a working holiday when their boss at the Daily Planet, Perry White, sends them on an assignment to Niagara Falls to uncover a honeymoon hotel scandal. But Lois is more intent on uncovering Superman's real identity. And she's convinced she just made a huge mistake suspecting Clark Kent.
Boy, I sure must have looked like an idiot. Jumping in the river waiting for Mr. Wonderful. Who obviously had better things to do.
Oh, well, I'm sure it must have been something very important, Lois.
And then thinking that you were... Harry White can see me now. Where's my comb? God, not only have I lost my mind, I've lost my comb. Clark, can you pass me that brush over there, please?
Sure.
A clumsy stumble, and Clark lands in the fire in more ways than one.
Clark, let me look at it.
Does Clark Kent let Lois Lane see his hand is unburned? Does she really find out who Superman is once and for all? Christopher Reeve believes Clark Kent and Superman really want to be found out.
People who are accident prone are generally trying to be noticed. And in a larger sort of way, that's what's happening with Superman, if he's trying very hard to keep a handle on the reality that I must not let anybody know. But it's coming out by itself. You know, make little mistakes. He desperately wants to be discovered.
So, the stage is set for Superman's greatest challenge ever. Zod, Ursa, and Nan seek only total domination and destruction. To take over the entire world and all its inhabitants, they swear they'll stop at nothing, not even complete annihilation, to reach their goal. And when Superman chooses to step in their way, so much the better. Does Superman let that happen? Does the impossible romance that the world has watched unfold ever so slowly over all these years finally come to flower? That's an answer that only Superman 2 can provide. In retrospect, Christopher Reeve thought about the legendary Man of Steel and why he's managed to outlive all the other superheroes for almost half a century.
I think it must have something to do with the fact that the character himself is, in very simple psychological terms, is dead accurate in terms of how people want to see themselves. Clark Kent is a kind of exaggerated portrayal of who we really are, and Superman is the fantasy that we dream about when we're alone. To have both of these wrapped up in one person is too good to be true. You're planting a lot of very powerful images with people, having to do with roots and heritage and fantasy and fulfillment. Flying is a very powerful attraction to people, too. It's a sexual metaphor. But all these things combined in one person is very, very rare. And that's why he's so fascinating. People are looking at their dreams when they look at Superman. He's the original.
History of Superman Radio Special was written by Laurie Kay and Peter Rubenstein. Produced by Ron Hummel. Program concept and direction by Peter Rubenstein. This has been a Riches and Rubenstein production in association with Klein Mednick Productions. For the History of Superman, this is John Leader.
Tune in again for the next thrilling episode with Superman. Yeah.
We'll be right back.